So why should they invest? What are the benefits? So security. Number one is security. And it's titled security on purpose, right? We want to make sure that this person at first is going to feel secure. This is towards the very beginning of the presentation. So we want to make them understand that this is a safe environment, that this asset's going to be safe long term, secure, not safe. We want to say secure. And then we say, number one, this is cash flow from a real asset. So this is cash flow from a building, a structure, something that you can go and touch, that you can go and hold, right? You can walk through the units, you can see the building. It's a real thing. It's not on a computer screen, it's a real thing. Then number two, people will always need a place to rent because people will always need a place to live and people will always be renters. And not only will people need a place to rent, but more people are starting to want to rent rather than own. And there's actually a big demographic shift to a renter culture. So you can see here on the slide, we have a baby boomer in a suit and tie, and he's looking at a millennial. So the millennial has a red beanie on, and it's kind of a joke because he's such a stereotype down the fairway millennial. But the thing is, millennials don't want a place, like they don't want a house in the suburbs. They don't want the white picket fence. They don't want the 1.5 kids or however many the average kids are, like two kids and a boy and a girl and a white picket fence and the whole American dream thing. That doesn't really exist anymore. People want to live downtown where the culture is, go to nice restaurants and live downtown and rent. Like that's kind of more the new thing that people want. And millennials are becoming, the main generation, the bulk of the buying power. So there's a shift to a renter culture. Now we have control. So this is an income benefit. This isn't now a benefit. We're talking about, how much money this individual could potentially make. But it's not right out there on the nose, right? We're trying to, we're like, think about it, like we're kind of reeling them in because we have we have an idea of what we want to say to them later, but if they're not willing to accept it, then we can't say it to them, right? They're not going to accept it. So we have to kind of almost reel them in a sense. So control. You control the value of the building. And we talk about the NOI divided by cap rate equals purchase price formula. And we talk about how we control by raising the actual income or lowering the expenses, we directly impact the value of the building. So we're going to use this very simple example where, you have 50 units with a current NOI of $100,000. You have a cap rate of 5%. So if you take $100,000 and you divide it by 0.05, then you're going to get 2 million. So that's how we've come up with the $2 million purchase price. Now, we're going to do a very, very simple thing, which is just, I mean, and obviously this is simplified. Expenses are staying the same in this example, but we're going to increase rent $100 per door. And so basically, what you want to do is you want to get them to agree that doing this, raising the rent $100 a door, is not that big a deal, right? So you want to be like, yeah, it's just $100, not that big a deal. And it really isn't a big deal. So now we have 50 times 100, because 50 units times $100 times 12 months. That equals 60,000. So now you want to pause on the 60,000 number, and you want to say something along the lines of, $60,000 doesn't seem like that big a deal. And they may even say like, dude, 60,000, what is that even? Like, I thought we were talking about millions of dollars here. 60,000 is not really going to change my life, right? Well, the thing is, you're going to show them that it actually is going to mean a lot more on the back end than they think. So now we have, 50 units with an NOI of 160,000. So now we're going to take that 160,000 and we're going to divide that by 0.05. And that's actually going to make the purchase price 3.2. So now we have a profit of 1.2 million from a $100 change. And so that's something that's really important to show them is that, obviously this is oversimplified, but the thing is, it's the actual concept that if we can do a small change to income across several units, then we're actually going to see a huge increase of value on the back end. So we have a $100 increase, which is, everybody knows and everyone can wrap their head around, $100. We can all see something being worth $100 more, but no one really understands that that turns into 1.2 on the back end. And that's something that's important to show the individual because we controlled that rent increase and then we ended up making quite a bit of money. So that's a really good thing to show. So now we have proven. This is our first big claim. And it's important that we're connecting it to a credible source because if we leave this claim like wafting out in space, then it's going to be a different situation, right? Like, if you've ever watched a YouTube ad, right, for like someone with the Lamborghini in the background, and they're like, boom, if you want this Lamborghini, all you got to do is this. And then you're like, okay, this guy is ridiculous. I immediately don't want to hear anything you have to say. Skip, skip, skip. And you, as soon as it hits zero, you skip. So we don't want to be that guy. We're trying to distance ourselves from that guy literally as far away as possible, as much as we can. This guy's here. We want to be as like across the room. So we're going to ask the question, do you know what industry's made more millionaires than every other industry combined? And they're going to be like, I don't know. What industry? And you can say, real estate. And then they're like, are you sure? And you'll be like, yeah, here's this quote from Andrew Carnegie. And Andrew Carnegie goes on to say, 90% of all millionaires became so through owning real estate. The wise young man or wage earner of today would invest his money in real estate. So that's a pretty good quote. That's a pretty good quote from an individual who is one of the wealthiest humans who's ever lived. And he's just said that 90% of all millionaires became so through owning real estate. And that also, if you're a wise person, you're going to do the same. So now we've been able to actually be credible here, and we're connecting our credibility to someone who is much more credible than ourselves. So it becomes less like the YouTube commercial guy and more like a real credible fact and thing. Because we want to be credible. We are credible. We have good intentions here. We're trying to help this individual. But the thing is, they have to accept our information before we can really, you know, build this relationship and show them the true benefits. So we have tax benefits here. And this is an important thing to know, because here's where you get to really solidify yourself as an expert. So number one, we have depreciation. So if you look here at the bottom left corner, you'll have this house that's kind of dilapidated, it's falling down. Well, that's kind of what happens if you don't make any improvements to your building. And so the government's gonna give you a phantom expense write-off on a 27 and a half year period. And don't worry, we're gonna break these down in the next slides. These are each their own slide, so we will get into it. I just wanna give the overview for people who don't understand. Depreciation is the phantom expense for the overall, you know, falling apart of a structure. And the IRS deems that that takes 27 and a half years. So they're gonna give you a write-off because of that, and we'll break that down more later. Number two, cost segregation. So we have the ability to actually segregate the value within the building. So basically the structure that you're sitting in right now, the actual structure itself has value, sure, but also the things inside of that, like the desk I'm sitting at right now, has value, the cabinets, the appliances, things like that. And we can actually take that value and separate it from the other parts of the value, and that value will get taxed on a different schedule, on a shorter schedule as well, so that we're gonna be able to actually get more of a tax write-off from this. Then we have number three, which I'm gonna leave till we actually go through it. It's bonus depreciation. So it's a little bit more of a special way to do it. You have to be a real estate professional, and we'll talk about all of that coming up. So depreciation. We have a very corny hang loose here on the slide. I apologize for that, but you know, just trying to get some more attention because you may have fallen asleep at this point in the presentation. So we have a very corny hang loose. Depreciation. So the annual depreciation write-off. You have a $1 million value of the property, and this is simplified, so we're already separating, you know, the land out of it. We're just saying that this is $1 million value, and we're going to divide that by 27 and a half. And that's gonna give us an annual write-off of $36,363. So that's what you're gonna get to write off every year against your tax liability. So that's a pretty sweet situation. It's just the general depreciation, and we're gonna show you how to really amplify that. So now we have something called cost segregation. And as I alluded to earlier, we can separate into two main categories. Number one is land improvement. So land improvement means it's basically like sidewalks, landscaping. It's the things that we do, we improve the land in a certain way, it adds value, and it contributes to the value. So this is gonna be on a 15-year schedule. So anything that we can separate out into this category is now gonna be depreciated on a 15-year schedule instead of 27 and a half. So it's gonna be a lot more money for them. Then number two, we have personal property. So this is gonna be on a 5-year schedule. We have cabinets, appliances, etc. And these are gonna be things on a 5-year schedule. So now we can actually separate these out on a 5-year schedule. And I'm gonna show you an example here. So in multifamily, we can typically separate about 30% of value into these categories. So 30% of 1 million is 300,000. Then we have, you know, 20% of that total is personal property. So 20% of 1 million is 200,000. So now we can divide 200,000 by 5. That's going to give us $40,000. So you can see we're only 20% through here, and we're already over the regular depreciation. So this is a really powerful thing, and we'll go through the other ones here. So we still have land improvement to work with. It's going to be 10% of the overall value, which is going to be $100,000 divided by 15. That's going to give us $6,600. So now just from the 30% that we've separated, we have made over $10,000 in tax write-offs just from the 30%. And we still have 70% left over. So now we take that remaining 70%, $700,000, and we divide that by 27.5, and that's going to give us $25,000 and some change. So overall, our new write-off is going to be $72,000 a year instead of $36,000. So we basically doubled it, and that's the power of cost segregation. But wait, there's more, right? It gets even better. So bonus depreciation. If you qualify as a real estate professional, you can actually take 100% of the value that we separate in year one. So that 30% that we took out from into personal property and land improvement, that can all be taken in year one. So now not over a 5 and a 15 year time schedule, but over a 1 year. So the first year we can take $300,000 on against our taxes, which is pretty sweet. And if we don't use it all, it rolls over to the next year and then the next year. So it continues to roll over until we use it all. How do you qualify as a real estate professional? Because that sounds pretty sweet. I definitely want to get in on that. And this is also something that you're going to be, you know, this whole slide section is because you're trying to find out how you can get this individual you're meeting with more tax benefits. And the reason that I even talk about the bonus depreciation and the real estate professional clause is because I've actually gotten an investor this way, and I'll tell you how in a second. But first, let's define the real estate professional. So must provide more than one half of his or her personal services in real property business trades or in real property trades or businesses in which he or she materially participates. So basically you have to spend more than half your time in real estate and you have to materially participate. So you have to have money involved in your participation to be a real estate professional. Number two, and perform more than 750 hours a year of these real estate services. So that works out to about 15 hours a week. And so contractors, you know, architects, real estate agents, things like that. The thing is, most people that you're talking to won't be real estate professionals. But the cool thing about this is if their significant other or spouse is a real estate professional and they file jointly, then they both get the tax write-off. They both get to be real estate professionals on a tax paper. So if you can find that out, that's actually how I got an investor. He was a successful lawyer, not in real estate, not a real estate professional, but his wife was a real estate agent. So she qualifies, they file jointly, now they both qualify. I end up saving the guy a bunch of taxes and he's like, okay, cool, I definitely want to invest with this guy. He knows my situation now, he understands how to help me. And that's really the value, right? So because I understood the value and how to help this guy, he was willing to invest with me. It didn't matter. I didn't have to have some bio. I didn't have to have, you know, a CEO of, you know, blah, blah, blah capital. Like, you don't need to do that. You just need to know how to help this person. If I can give this guy tremendous value, which I did, then he's willing to invest with me. It doesn't matter anything else. It doesn't matter anything else, right? If you can give someone tremendous value, they will invest. That's all you need to focus on is how can I figure out this person's situation and how can I help them as much as humanly possible, more than anyone else, and then you will get them to invest. It's that simple.